Okay, so this is where we finished the Oracle model. We do a number of queries, and eventually we get an answer out. So the model in which we work is as follows. We start with all of our, say, ions in ground state, and we set up some initial supposition. Okay, then we ask our first question. We think about it, ask our second question, think about it, and so forth. And finally ask our last question, and after three questions, we do some post-processing, and then we measure and we get an outcome out. This is the generic form of any quantum algorithm that uses three queries. Right? And these unitaries here do not depend on the oracle. They don't depend on the envelopes. They are predefined. This is the specification of the algorithm. So if you specify the algorithm, what you give is the operators V0 up to VT, and specify this as T will be the last query, and then they say that this measurement is in the computational basis state. And what comes out on this wire here is the answer. And we may or may not want to measure all of these wires here. We might not just measure a bit, or we measure 10 bits, or measure maybe all of them. Okay. So any algorithm that takes T queries. Okay, so let's talk some about lower bounds also, and more about this model here. Okay, so we start our graduate studies. We have a bit of gray matter on the topic. And by each day, we sometimes have a flash of insight, and we grow a little bit more gray matter on the topic, or useful gray matter for that reason. And at the end, our supervisor hopes that we have a lot on gray matter on the topic. So the conclusion from this year is that it's going to take a lot of days. Because we go from very little to a lot, and each day of work only gives us very little. So if you have this scenario here where you know very little at the beginning, need to know a lot, and every day of work only changes us a little bit, we need a lot of days. Okay. So lower bound is that. It is that a thesis will take so many years to produce. Namely, if you know very little in the beginning, we have very little information, a lot of uncertainty at the beginning, and we learn only a little by each query, by each day of work, and we need to learn a lot, we need to have very little uncertainty at the end, then we can conclude that we need a lot of queries. Right. This is how lower bounds they go, information theoretic lower bounds. And all lower bounds of quantum computing, they are information theoretic lower bounds almost. And he uses this method here. So I'll actually use this model here with the phase oracles, but which is equivalent to the other oracle. So we do our pre-processing query, some thinking, another query thinking, and eventually our last query, and then post-processing, and then a measurement. Okay. Okay, so let's try to prove some lower bounds. In fact, we saw some lower bounds in the first lecture. We saw that sorting on three elements cannot be done in one query. We saw that you could search in one query if you have one out of four ones in four envelopes. Okay, but let's try to consider more lower bounds. Okay, so in this case here, I have four envelopes with four bits. Okay, I have four bits, x1 through x4. And the four envelopes contains one of these seven configurations. So either the four envelopes contain 0, 0, 0, 1, or 0, 1, 1, 0, and so forth. You know that it's one of these seven configurations. Okay. If I ask for what is in envelope number 1, let's say, and I get the answer, envelope 1 contains a 1. Well, then we learn it cannot be this configuration, it cannot be that input, and it cannot be that input. Because if it had been any of these inputs here, the answer here should have been zero, because in these three inputs here contains a zero in that envelope. So now we're down to four possible configurations, or four possible inputs it can be. So I've eliminated three possibilities out of seven possibilities. It's going pretty good. Well, I eliminate almost half. And then I can do my second query. Let's say I ask for what's in envelope number three, and I get the answer zero. Okay, so this answer here is inconsistent with that answer, and this input here is inconsistent with that answer. I eliminate them, and I'm down to two envelopes, this envelope and this envelope. Oh, this configuration or that configuration. And now I want to ask for what is in envelope four, because giving the answer to what's in envelope four will distinguish this input here, which has a one in the fourth envelope, and that input, which has a zero in the fourth envelope. Okay, so that's if you want to distinguish seven possible inputs, an algorithm for how to proceed. You start by, it's really by elimination. Eliminate all the possibilities that are inconsistent with the answers that are being obtained. Okay, let's play another game. Now I'm actually not interested in knowing which of these seven possibilities I have. I'm just only interested in knowing, is it one of these three inputs, or is it one of those four inputs? Okay? So I don't care whether it's that input, or that input, or that input. I just want to know, is it one of these three inputs, or one of those four inputs? Which is the case? This or that? Yes or no? Zero or one? It's a decision problem. Is it the input, does it come from this set, or does the input come from that set? Okay, give me an algorithm. Okay, but let's think about how to solve this here. Okay, in some sense, what it is that you want to do is you want to distinguish pairs of input, right? You don't want to have an uncertainty among whether you have that input or that input. So if you don't know whether you have that input or that input, you cannot tell whether you come from that set or that set. Okay, but if you ask for what's in envelope number one, and we get the answer one, then we know that it could potentially be this one here, but it cannot be that input, because it contains a zero in the first envelope. So if we query one, then we can distinguish between this input and that input. In fact, if you query the first bit, the first envelope, you can distinguish these pairs of inputs. Because wherever there is an edge, they contain something different in the first envelope. So this input here contains a zero in the first envelope. This input contains a one in the first input. So if you ask for what's in the first envelope, you'll be able to eliminate either that or that. You will have no uncertainty among that edge. And you have 12 edges, 3 times 4 edges to eliminate. And this query here will eliminate some of them. Not all of them, but some of them. Okay. Okay? So there are all these edges we want to eliminate. And I colored them by what? They're not all the same color. I colored them with respect to how many bits they differ on. Right? If you take the red edge is kind of a hard edge. To know whether you have this configuration here or that configuration here is very difficult. Your only choice is to ask for what is in envelope number four, because it's the only bit on which they differ. So this here is a very hard edge. I call it red. They only differ in one location. Whereas the green guy are the easy guy, because they differ everywhere, right? Whether you ask the first envelope, the second envelope, the third or the fourth envelope, doesn't matter. You'll be able to distinguish them. Okay. So we have 12 sets of input pairs. We want to distinguish between to know whether the input comes from that set or that set. And in some sense, they come with a weight, how difficult it is to distinguish that pair, depending on what query you do. And here I've just labeled them by their weights. So this is a very difficult edge to distinguish, and this is a very easy edge to distinguish. Okay, I mean, really, I had 7 inputs in total. I just cared about these 12 here. But if you think of this here as a matrix, it's natural to really sort of make it complete and complete this out here. The zeros here, they correspond to, I don't care about distinguishing these 3 guys from those 3 guys. And this zero here corresponds to, I don't care about distinguishing these 4 guys from those 4 guys because they come all from the same set. And I was only interested in, did you come from that set or not? So, also further, this 2 is the same as that 2, right? Because distinguishing pairs is symmetric. I mean, where you can distinguish this input here, 0, 1, 1, 0, from 0, 0, 0, 1. Or if I do the other way around, distinguish 0, 0, 0, 1 from 0, 1, 1, 0, it's the same thing. Can distinguish them, yes or no? Distinguishing A from B is the same as distinguishing B from A. So I have a symmetric matrix. And there's 0, and this is a block diagonal, and I have zeros on the block, on the diagonal in these blocks. As to the sets, I don't care about distinguishing. And I've put weights on them in terms of how difficult they are to distinguish. Okay. Now, there's really no reason why these weights should be positive. If I wanted to, I could pick negative weights. Why not? I mean, I set the rules. You're not allowed to eat in this room. So -1, how do you want to think about -1? If the positive numbers, they correspond to how difficult is it to distinguish a particular pair, smaller weight, the +1 here, is really that it's very easy to distinguish, and a big number corresponds to it's very difficult to distinguish. How would you want to think about negative numbers? Yeah, not having to distinguish them, then I would really put a 0. So this here really corresponds to you don't have to distinguish them. But now I put negative numbers. No, it's not necessarily the case that your algorithm have to distinguish them here, or any algorithm will necessarily distinguish it here just because I put a minus. Negation of the other? No. Because I can also take this 3 and put it into -3. Why shouldn't I? I mean, I could do that if I wanted to.
No, but I mean, if to convert from one of them to the other, like
you just like invert. So I pick these numbers, and I happen to pick them with respect to Hamming weights. The difference in Hamming, the Hamming distance. Yeah. But I could pick some of the numbers negative. I pick these numbers, and I pick these numbers. I could pick any number I wanted. Okay, so we won't cover that, I guess. No, you can think about negative numbers as I'm penalizing if you're able to distinguish them. If you're able to distinguish them, I'm going to penalize you. You better not be able to. That's what the negative corresponds to. Okay, let's continue. Let's just make it positive for simplicity for now, because it's easier conceptually to think about. But this is the difference between the adversary method and the negative adversary method. That the negative adversary methods allow this additional step. Okay.
I'm sorry, I still don't understand, why we want to put the minus,
Because it gets better lower bounds. Okay. we'll get to it. We'll get to it. So you are an algorithm.
Because it would be a waste of time to spend the step trying to.
No. So Okay, think about it as follows. Let me go a few steps down here and then get back to it.
Sure.
Okay. So these are the weights that correspond to the difficulty of distinguishing those pairs. And I sum them all up, all of those weights. So it'll be twice all of these numbers here it adds up to. Or if you want to, you can just really, if you think of this 7x7 matrix as a matrix gamma, and this here is the all one vector here, it's just this inner product here. Right? This here corresponds to adding all of the numbers up inside this matrix, 7x7 matrix. Because this is the all one vector, and this gamma here is the 7x7 matrix, and this is the all one vector. Okay, so these are my initial weights.
Why are you focusing on distinguishing them in pairs? Because if you're giving one of the seven states, you can distinguish
the pairwise. So I define the problem as distinguishing these three from those four. But we could take another problem to solve. But I just defined it as such. This is a problem I want to I want to solve. Okay, so you have four envelopes, and I promise you a priori that the four envelopes contains one of seven configurations, one of these seven configurations here. And I would like to know, not which one of these seven configurations my four envelopes are in, but whether the configuration is one of those three or one of those four. Say I can ask you, another question of that type would be, there is a student. Okay, so I could know which student it is, but maybe I'm not interested in it. Maybe I could just ask, well, is it a male student or is it a female student? So it's one set against another set. Is it from that set or this set? So is it from this set or is it from that set? That's the question I'm interested in here. So don't care about the name of the student, I just care about the sex of the student in that case. It's a binary decision, A or B. Okay, let's go back. If you want to know whether you come from that set or that set, what you have to be able to do is you have to be able to distinguish pairs. If you come from this set here, or if you come from that set here, you know. If I also promised, let's say that you came from this set here, then if I had promised you that you're either this guy or that guy, you could distinguish, you could say that, well, you're this guy here because you came from that set. So you have eliminated this set here. You have eliminated that edge. You don't have an uncertainty as to whether you have this guy or that guy. Distinguishing between set is equivalent to distinguish between all of the pairs between those two sets. That's right. If we also want to distinguish within each set, we also have to distinguish between all of the edges in between here.
This is the, you've removed pairs from within the set.
We have removed pairs within this, all the possible pairs, 7x6 possible pairs.
Yeah.
And said that those pairs we're not interested in distinguishing. Okay, I'll try. Yeah, go ahead.
So you're saying that some pairs are distinguished by querying just a single bit, right?
Some of these pairs I can, if you know a priori whether you have this input or that input, then you can distinguish between those two inputs with just one query by just querying, say, the fourth envelope. And if the fourth envelope is a one, and you're given the promise that it's either that input, then you know that it's that input and not that input. Yeah, under the premise that it's one of those. So this uncertainty edge here is now being eliminated.
And will building on this premise give you an efficient
So we'll get to how to build algorithms out of this here, or lower bounds for algorithms. So this matrix here, if you sum up all of that here, is the amount of uncertainty you have between all of the pairs of inputs you want to distinguish. Adding all of those numbers here is your total uncertainty. Okay. If you query the first envelope, say you query the first envelope, then you eliminate all of these seven edges here. Because in all of these cases here, this input here contains a 1, that input contains, this first envelope contains a 0, this first envelope contains a 1, you can distinguish this pair. This first envelope contains a 1, this first envelope contains a 0, you can distinguish that pair. You have eliminated those 7 edges if you query the first envelope. So the total amount of weight that you remove by querying the first envelope is that sum. And which is just that matrix here, this gamma 1 will be that matrix. It's the restriction of gamma onto the indices or the entries where the first bit is different. And that's also an inner product. It's just sum up that whole matrix here, but you sum up the gamma 1 matrix, which is gamma restricted to all of the pairs where the first bit is different. Okay. At the end of the day, after doing t queries, we want to have eliminated all but an epsilon small part of our initial uncertainty, say. So it doesn't necessarily do it here deterministically or with certainty. We just want to eliminate most of our uncertainty. Okay, so it's okay there are some edges here that are still surviving here, or a lot of edges with very little probability left at the very end. But at the end, we want to eliminate most of our initial uncertainty. Okay, so that's our goal. So we'll be able to distinguish between this set and that set here with high likelihood, with high probability. Okay. So from this large initial uncertainty, very small drop in the uncertainty by any one query, and we want to remove a lot of uncertainty, implies that we need lots of queries. So we have lots of queries, a lot of uncertainty initially. We can remove very little uncertainty by each query, and we want to remove most of the uncertainty. That gives a lower bound for the number of queries. That is how lower bounds go. All of them. Almost. Ket 1, the all 1 vector. So it's 7 ones. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So up here, this is all 7 ones, and this is gamma, and this is 7 ones. And that corresponds to just adding up everything inside this matrix.
Can you show the old matrix one more time?
The all matrix, yeah, I can. So adding it up, is that what you mean?
No, just flash.
Further back. Okay. So these are all of them. Oh, sorry. I need to go one back. Okay, so this is what we have. And this here is a classical lower bound. This is a classical lower bound. This here. Okay, there's nothing quantum. I use ket notation here, but everything we argued about was classical. So this is a classical lower bound method. Okay. Yeah?
Why are we using here epsilon? I mean, if you want the best lower bound, we should put epsilon prime equal 0 on the region.
Yeah. For exact quantum algorithms, we want epsilon to be 0. For a two-sided bounded error algorithms, we want epsilon small. So if we don't care about removing all of the uncertainty, but we just want to, in the end, to be able to distinguish between pairs with high likelihood, then there will be a small epsilon, a small residual uncertainty.
So here we are talking about the probabilistic context.
Yeah. And quantumly, you just take this vector and replace by other vectors. And this here is the negative adversary method, which is tight. This here gives provable optimal lower bounds for all quantum black box algorithms. Any problem you have that can be solved in the query model is by some number of queries here has a matching lower bound that is tied using this method here. That's all there is to it. This is the negative adversary method. The problem is being reduced to come up with this gamma matrix. That's all what remains. For any problem up here, all what you care about is to find this matrix here. The 12 entries here. What do you put the weights to be? Then you plug that in into this formula here, and that spits out a number. And that's your lower bound. And the bigger that number can be, the better.
So why do we use the phi in the
denominator? This is what the lower bound is. So I should keep a little bit of eye on the time, so I don't. I'll pass it for now. But this is the lower bound. This is the norm of gamma, and this is the norm of gamma I. Because this here can be anything. Psi can be anything, and phi can be anything. So this here is the norm of gamma. This is the norm of gamma I. So this is the amount of uncertainty you have, and this here is the maximum amount of uncertainty you can eliminate by one query. So that gives a lower bound of the number of queries, allowing for a small residual uncertainty at the end. Okay, so let's apply this lower bound for binary searching. So we have already seen binary searching on 3 inputs, now we are going to do binary searching on 7 inputs, or 6 inputs. Okay, so there are 6 possible inputs, and they are in sorted order what's in these 5 envelopes. And there are 6 possible configurations, starting from all zeros to all ones, and in sorted order. And what we're interested in, find the index of the leftmost one. So you know that this is, we're looking up a name in a phone book, in a sorted phone book. Okay, classically this takes log n queries. You just split the phone book in the middle and recurse log n. Okay, what about quantumly? Okay, so let's devise a lower bound using this method. Okay, so now we have 6 inputs, possible inputs. We want to distinguish all possible 6 inputs against all possible 6 inputs. Right? So let's start with this index here. So let's say that for this pair of inputs, let's say that you are promised a priori that you have either that input or that input. Right? How difficult is that? Well, let's put a number. I put 1. I put 1 divided by 1, which is 1. Okay, just to start somewhere. And then symmetrically, I'll make this symmetric because they did, it's the same. Distinguish A from B is the same as distinguish B from A. And I'll put 1 everywhere off diagonals. Because this here is really kind of the same as that here, because this is this input against that input. The only differ in the second last position, whether this is 0 or whether it's 1. They are of Hamming distance 1. Okay, so what about this index here? I'll put a half, because in some sense their Hamming distance is 2. Right, so in some sense this is half as hard as that problem. If this has some hardness here, this is kind of like half as hard, because I have 2 choices here, where 2 envelopes here where I can distinguish this from that, Whereas here, I only have one choice to distinguish this input from that input. And then I'll do this symmetrically. And the rest I'll fill out similarly. So just by natural thinking about, well, how hard are these pairs to distinguish here, we'll end up with this matrix here. In terms of how lucky are you to distinguish a particular pair if you query a particular envelope. There's nothing magical going on here. And now I'll plug it into the formula and see what comes out. So now I have all of my weights. How much weight is there in this matrix here in total? We'll figure this out. Okay, so the initial weight is just the sum of all of the numbers in this matrix. You just sum up all of these numbers. Okay, any query, any one query can eliminate part of the uncertainty of that matrix here by this amount here at the most. And we want to eliminate most of the uncertainty except for an epsilon fraction. Okay, then we get a lower bound, that is, how much do we need to eliminate, and how much can you eliminate by one query? That's the number of queries you need to apply at the least. Okay, for our matrix here, this is, the sum is log n, the spectral norm of this matrix here, the sum of one row here, average out of all of the rows here is log n, of order log n, slightly harmonic number. So if this was n by n, the sum of the nth harmonic number is roughly log n. So the initial weight of all of those here scaled down by factor of n is log n. The whole matrix has some n log n, and one row on average has some log n. The spectral norm of this matrix log of order log n. The spectral norm, if you do one query, is of order 1. It's all bounded by a constant of pi, or pi over 2, or something. And suppose, to sort of see this a little bit here, suppose that you query the fourth envelope. If we query the fourth envelope, then we could, for instance, learn that this is 0, 0, which would distinguish him from all of the envelopes that contains a 1 in the fourth envelope. We'll learn all of these bits here. And similarly, all of those bits here. So we have two off-block diagonal matrices you learn, either this block or that block. And the spectral norm of that submatrix is upper bounded by a constant. One can prove this. It's not too difficult. It's actually an old result. So we have this much uncertainty in the beginning. Each query can eliminate almost that much uncertainty by each query. We need a lot of queries. Log n. So this here formally proves, that any quantum algorithm for binary searching will require log n queries. It is not possible quantumly to speed up ordered searching from the classical binary searching. Any quantum algorithm for order searching will take log n queries. You can speed it up by some constant factor, but not more than a constant factor. In fact, also sorting cannot be sped up. It takes of order n log n quantumly as classically. And this is the way that one can prove it. Okay? And this is optimal. I could have done that too. If I had picked 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, I will not get as good a lower bound. So that's why I didn't do it. So I would not get as good a lower bound if I picked 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So I picked the ratios instead. You could try to, I actually forget what you get, what lower bound you get, but you'll get some lower bound if you pick 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And you get some lower bound out, but it will not be good enough. I think it might even just be a constant, the lower bound.
How do you identify the lower
What's that?
How do you identify the good lower bounds?
So this method here can be used to prove optimal lower bounds. So if I exhibit an algorithm that yields an upper bound that matches this lower bound, then I know that my lower bound is optimal and it cannot be improved. So I know a priori that this method here has the ability to produce optimal lower bounds. And the way I define good lower bounds is that it's better than what was known in the past and it's better than what is obvious. And whenever you have a lower bound, and if you can prove that lower bound, then you get a better lower bound and you make some progress. And the carrot here is that you know that this method, if you tweak it enough, it can produce optimal lower bounds. It's not obvious how to. That's the creative part of it. What to pick these entries to be. So I can pick any numbers here I want. It just needs to be symmetric. And I can even pick negative numbers. So it's extremely free. I can pick whatever I want.
But as long as they correspond to the distinguishability.
Yeah, as long as this here is zero, because I don't care about distinguishing this input from that input. That doesn't make sense. So you just put zero where you don't care about distinguishing things. And anything else can be whatever you want, whatever you feel like.
So out of that freedom, you have to sort of optimize your choice of weights?
Out of that, you hire 10,000 students, and you give them different types of matrices to search for, and hopefully one of them will pan out. No, yeah, that's the art, okay. The unknown. Okay. Who knows? That's understanding your problem somehow, get some insight, and then eventually you end up with something that works.
So how do I see from this setup, what's the quantum lower bound and what's the classical lower bound? Because on the previous example, you would just...
Yeah, there was a classical lower bound, and I won't delve into it here, so you cannot extract it from my talk.
Okay.
So, but... there are other ways to prove classical lower bounds. We just don't discuss it today, unfortunately.
But it's not just a special case of this is just...
No. There are many ways to prove both classical lower bounds and quantum lower bounds. But what is both surprising and very appealing and not something that happens in the classical world is that this method quantumly gives optimal lower bounds. There's no such thing classically other than some obscure reformulation that doesn't really give any insight. Where this here really provides some insight. That this here is optimal is that this method can give optimal lower bound is really remarkable. It's rare that that happens in lower bound, unless you just do some reformulation that into something else that is useless. Yeah, it's not obvious that these spectral norms are what I claim they are. And one needs to do a little bit of calculations. Let's take it as a claim. Certainly, this spectral norm is upper bound by log n because the sum of any row is upper bound by log n. So the spectral norm cannot be more than the sum of the rows.
Well,
it's
not the sum of everything.
No, here I took the spectral norm, I divided by n. So the sum of everything is n times log n. I only took the spectral norm. Something else? Okay. There is another method which is also appealing quantumly, which is called the polynomial method. But this one here does provably not always yield optimal lower bounds. It yields some lower bound, but not necessarily optimal. But it's an entirely different method, which is based on algebraic methods, which is also inspired from classical computations. This is, okay. But whereas the other method, the adversary method, gives optimal, can produce optimal lower bounds if you get the right adversary matrix, this one provably cannot always give optimal lower bounds. There are problems for which this method doesn't give very good lower bounds in its current form. There might be a variation of this method here which would yield optimal bounds, but we don't know of such a variant. Just like initially for the adversary method, there was a variant that not always gave optimal bounds. It was only by introducing negative numbers in the adversary method that you actually can show that it produced optimal lower bounds always. Okay, so to get back to the, to discuss the polynomial method now for proving lower bounds here, let's go back to the query model. And let's take this query model here. You ask for what is in envelope number I, and here's your coin. You flip the coin if the ith envelope contains a 1, and you don't flip the coin if the ith envelope contains a 0. And flipping twice undoes it, so this thing is unitary. It's reversible. Okay, so we go back to this way of querying Oracle. Okay. Now what would happen if we put this one, this state here, into our query? So since this here I can put in a superposition of I and something in this target register here. So I put I comma 0 and I put I comma 1 with some different amplitudes, alpha and beta. Okay, what comes out? Well, if the ith envelope contains a 0, then I don't flip the target bit. It remains 0 or 1. But if the ith envelope contains a 1, then I flip the target register, which is equivalent to flipping the amplitudes. So I swap alpha and beta. That's what the Oracle does on a superposition. Okay. If I wanted, I could really rewrite this in a very complicated way just to make life hard. Right? Because, see, what is the amplitude in front of I comma 0? It is alpha if xi is 0, and it's beta if xi is 1, which is equivalent to this expression here. If xi is 0, then I should get alpha. If xi is 0, then this is 0. This is beta times xi. If xi is 0, this here gives alpha. If xi is 1, then I should get beta out. If xi is 1, then I get beta out and no alpha. So this is equal to it. It's just a complicated way of writing it. But what's so nice about it is that I'm working with the amplitudes again. Just like the phase oracle worked with amplitudes, I'm now back to working with phases, which is the preferred space you want to work in. Not the computational states, but phases. Phases are the important part. Here I have an amplitude, and here I have an amplitude. And if you think of it, you can really think of this expression here as an algebraic expression, which is a polynomial. It's a polynomial in xi. And it's a polynomial of degree 1 in xi. And similar, this here is a polynomial of degree 1 in xi. Or if you want to say, it's a polynomial of degree 1 in all of the xi's. I mean, the other xi, xj, j different from I, just doesn't occur here. These are linear polynomials at the most. I mean, this here is actually at the most one, because this thing here could be a polynomial of degree 0. If alpha and beta were equal, both 1 over square root of 2, then you have square root of 2 xi, and then minus square root of 2 xi, which will cancel out. So the polynomials of degree at most 1. In the variables xi's. So if you think of this here as polynomials in the envelopes, the content of the envelopes, these are linear polynomials at the most. Okay, so let's go back to our generic. Any quantum algorithm for black box computing can be written as such, where you pre-process, do a query, think about it, do a second query, and so on, until you've done T queries. Any quantum algorithm has a form. And notice what comes out is this expression that comes out here at the end will be a polynomial of degree at most t in all of the variables xi's. And this is not entirely obvious. So initially, before you have made no query, at this point here, you have degree zero polynomials, because you haven't interacted with the oracle. So these expressions of all of the amplitudes will be some numbers, some strange numbers, but they cannot depend on the XIs. They cannot. They can only depend on whatever this thing here does, which may do something difficult. So here you have degree zero polynomials in XIs. And after this operation here, after the first query will take whatever amplitude comes in, alpha or beta, and increase the degree by at most one. It will increase the degree of the polynomials that come in of all of the amplitudes and increase it by at most one. And this here happens at most t times. So the final degree can be at most t. At most. It can be less because things can cancel out.
But what if I, on one of the, well, not the first one, but one of the other query boxes, become the polynomial in the XI, then we have.
And these things here are linear operators. So if you take two polynomials here in between, they're linear. So if you take two polynomials of degree three and you do something linear with them, you still have a new polynomial of degree three.
Yes, but
they will not increase the degree of the polynomials.
If I is, let's say for the second ux, we have I equals xi. So then we will have x of xxi, I mean, it won't be a polynomial, it would be x, the indices of which will depend on the first one.
Yeah, so after two queries, you can have something of the form xi squared and xi xj and xj squared.
No.
But the total degree that sits on all of the xi's for each of the monomial in the polynomial expression will be of degree, at total degree at most two. Yeah. No. So let's say that you do your second query on this state here, the second query. Then this here is just your new alpha. Call it alpha prime. Then you put alpha prime up here, and you have a degree one here times something of degree one here, degree one times degree one, degree two.
That's not what I was saying. What if
maybe we could take this question online afterwards? We're running out of time. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Okay. So, but think about it here, that after t queries, all of in the superposition, every state in that superposition, that amplitude that sits in front here will be a polynomial of degree at most t in the xi's. That gives a lower bound method. And let's apply it on parity. You saw when Martin Rödler, he gave his presentation, that computing the parity of two bits, this is the Deutsch-Josiah algorithm, you compute the parity of two bits in one query. So you can compute the parity of n bits in n divided by two queries, because you take your n bits and you bundle them into pairs of two, and for each of those you compute the parity in one query. Now you have n divided by two outcomes, and you parity them up classically post-processing. Okay, so n bits, the parity of n bits can compute it with n divided by two queries quantumly. We know that from Martin Rödler's talk. Okay, here is an algebraic expression for the parity of three bits. If you have three bits that are zero or one each, and you want to compute the parity of those, then you can think of this here, this polynomial here as representing that function. Say, if all three bits are 1, x1, x2, x3 are all equal to 1, then this whole thing here adds up to 1. And it is indeed, all three 1s being 1, this is odd parity, it should add up to 1. So it would be 1 plus 1 plus 1 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1 plus 1 adds up to plus 1. If you have even parity, this thing here will add up to, I should have a 2 here, right? There should be a 2 here and a 2 here and a 2 here to cancel out. So it's two of them, 1, this is 1, this is 1, this is minus 2 then. And then I should have a plus 4 here. Okay, so I need to scale, I need to change the scalars. I'll change that slide. Okay, but there are scalars in front of these monomials that you can pick, namely 2 and 4, so that this expression here represents parity. Okay. And this polynomial here is unique. So we know that there is, in an algebraic expression that represents parity, that there is a monomial of degree 3, namely this one here. And in general, for parity of n bits, the degree will be n. This thing here will always exist. One can easily prove that. Okay, so you know a priori that parity can be represented by an algebraic expression that has degree n. Okay, that implies that the exact quantum query complexity of parity is n over 2. Because if you have a quantum algorithm that exactly solves, so no uncertainty, I mean exactly, with certainty you get the right answer out. What you get after applying your quantum algorithm, after t queries here, will be polynomials of degree t. And then when you perform a measurement, you take those amplitudes and you square them to get the probabilities. And then if you square a polynomial, then you double the degree at the most. So the success probability of an algorithm that uses t queries can be represented as a polynomial of degree at most 2t. So if you have an algorithm that uses less than n over 2 queries that solves parity exactly, then you will end up with a corresponding algebraic expression you could get out from it that would have degree strictly less than n, contradicting the fact that there's a unique expression here of degree n that solves parity. And that represents parity. So this is a low bound method. It is that you start with a polynomial representing the function you're interested in computing, computes its exact degree, and then you can conclude that whatever that degree is, there's a corresponding lower bound of half that degree in terms of how many queries you need quantumly. Second, it's also known that the approximate degree of parity is of order n. So even if you want to have a polynomial that did not exactly is equal, that algebraic expression is not always equal to 1 when the parity is 1, when parity is odd. It's not always equal to 0 when parity is even, but almost. So you have an algebraic expression that's almost equal to 1 if the parity is 1. And you have an algebraic expression that's almost equal to 0 when the parity is even. That's the approximate degree. It is known that the approximate degree of parity is of order n. And that implies also that the two-sided bounded error quantum complexity of parity is of order n. You need of order n queries quantumly to solve parity, even if you allow for errors, two-sided errors. This is a proof. For symmetric functions, the polynomial method gives optimal lower bound, and they're very easy, short to write down here once one is getting familiar with the polynomial method and these algebraic arguments that's being used a lot in classical computer science. It's almost cleaner than the adversary lower bound method for this type of problem for symmetric functions. And one interesting thing is there's actually, from quantum computing here, because any quantum algorithm yields a polynomial, people have actually found polynomial that approximates functions that we are interested in that one could not otherwise have found, that we know of no other way of finding. So it's ironic, it's sort of interesting that from devising a quantum algorithm, which is very simple and natural to define, you can get a polynomial out of it. Okay, so you write down the polynomial for better while quantum computing, now you just got your polynomial and see what is discovered in the classical literature, and it turns out that this is an open problem. Find an approximate polynomial for that function. It's not known what the optimal degree is. Well, for quantum, one can then, in certain cases, prove that this is that these approximate polynomials are optimal. So it gives something back to the algebraic community. Okay. So this is a summary, the main theorem of these two here, which yields lower bounds, but not always optimal lower bounds. Okay. So I've talked about a lot, and now let's just summarize what I've talked about. Okay, so this is the last slide. So we talked about oracles in the query model. Right? So many algorithms that gives a polynomial speed up work in that model here. And the normal computational basis state oracle and the phase oracle that we can use. We further discuss this model here, the query model, and we look, for instance, at 1 out of 4 envelopes. We rewrite Grover's iterate and prove Grover's algorithm and how it works. We show that two reflection yields a rotation. We rediscovered Grover's algorithm, and we found lower bound using adversary method for in this model. We discussed the adversary matrix and distinguishability, how that relates to computing. And we discussed the polynomial method. So this is the last slide, and thank you so much for your attention.